Coffee and caffeine. Do you drink coffee? Do you know the benefits or the harms of consuming caffeine? Are you having trouble sleeping? Do you have trouble thinking? So stay until this video and let's get to know more about coffee. Hi there, my name is Eduardo Corassa. I'm most known in Brazil as Dr. Corassa. I'm a clinical nutritionist that have saved its own life through what we call natural hygiene. The science of health, a model of lifestyle medicine that it actually can suggest that we can prevent and treat disease all through our biological needs. No needs of treatments, remedies, pills, nothing whatsoever besides interaction with nature, sunshine, diet, exercise, sleep, and a healthy lifestyle. So coffee contains hundreds of nutrients, biologically active compounds, including polyphenols, chlorogenic acids, lignans, melanoidins, and modest amounts of magnesium, potassium, and vitamin B3, niacin. So all these nutrients can reduce oxidative stress, can improve the gut microbiome, can modulate glucose and fat metabolism. So is there a maximum dose for coffee? Yes, there's actually a lethal dose for caffeine. Not by drinking coffee, but with caffeine supplements. You'd have to drink in a short time 75 to 100 cups of coffee to become lethal. But who does that? It's actually impossible. But there were deaths correlated with caffeine tablets, supplements, or liquids. Have you ever seen a lethal dose for bananas or broccoli? NASA actually did an experiment with spiders a long time ago. NASA gave actually spiders different kinds of substances to see how that affected the spider capacity to develop webs. So the more toxic the chemical, the more deformed the web looks in comparison with a normal web. So this is marijuana, benzedrine, caffeine, chlorohydrate. You can see that coffee was actually the almost the worst substance for a spider to construct its own web. So there are actually benefits from coffee and there are actually bad things from coffee. Yes, there are actually good effects and bad effects because coffee is actually a plant. So every plant in the world has a lot of nutrients, a lot of phytochemicals, but also coffee, you are incapable from eating the coffee bean from itself. The roasting process of the coffee make it loses a lot of nutrients. So some of the collateral effects of high doses of coffee is anxiety, restlessness, nervousness, dysphoria, insomnia, excitement, psychomotor agitation, rambling flow of thoughts and speech. Toxic effects are estimated to occur with intakes of 1.2 grams or higher, and a dose of 10 to 14 grams is thought to be fatal. 14 grams of caffeine, guys, this is such a small amount for such a lethal dose that for me, caffeine is a no-go always. So according to this research, it can raise blood pressure. It can actually reduce fetal development and increases the risk of losing the pregnancy, but it also can reduce skeletal muscle insulin sensitivity in the short term, but tolerance appears to develop with habitual intake. Abstinence symptoms. Have you ever seen any natural and good physiological substance make you crave it and develop abstinence when you lack? When I go a week without bananas, I don't go bananas. I don't go crazy. I don't go nuts when I drop broccoli from my diet, when I drop figs, when I drop watermelon. But with coffee, have you ever tried to say bad things about coffee to a coffee addict? Have you ever seen a broccoli addict? I never, but I have seen many coffee addicts. First of all, if you're not subscribed to the channel, subscribe, hit the bell button to get notification, comment below, give it a thumbs up, and share with everybody that you know that needs to drop out coffee. So what are the usual abstinence symptoms from dropping coffee? Quite simple. Headaches, fatigue, decreased alertness, depressed mood, influenza-like symptoms. This is from 1 to 2 days after quitting coffee, and from 2 to 9 days can be reduced gradually by decreasing the caffeine dose. The symptoms can be reduced drastically by reducing throughout more than a week. Caffeine and sleep. Probably the main person I'll be trash talking about coffee publicly, in the US at least, it was Matthew Walker. And I like him a lot, not just because of his work is magnificent, but also because he tells the truth, independent of what people like to hear. People always love to hear good things about the bad habits, as Joe McDougall once said. And what most people don't actually realize is that coffee interferes with sleep. We have what we call adenosine, that is a sleep pressure, like a pressure cooker, that when you are awake, this adenosine keeps accumulating in your brain. But as coffee is an antagonist for adenosine, it blocks the receptor in the cell, so you don't feel when you're sleepy, but you just crash from one moment to the other without any energy whatsoever, because you are just not feeling the adenosine building up. And what you have to realize that the half-life of the coffee is 6 hours, but 1/4 of its life is 12 hours. If you take a coffee at noon, it's similar to waking up at midnight, drinking 1/4 of a cup of coffee and trying to go back to sleep. The coffee at midnight that you took at noon is still in your bloodstream, making its psychoactive stimulant effects. So according to Matthew Walker, caffeine consumption later in the day can increase sleep latency and reduce the quality of sleep. So that's sleep latency, it means the amount of time you go to bed and start entering sleep stage. Also, coffee can produce anxiety, as we have said before, particularly at high doses, more than 200 milligrams per occasion or 400 milligrams per day. And in sensitive persons, primarily in those with anxiety or bipolar disorders. Caffeine blocks and effectively inactivates adenosine receptors, acting as a masking agent. It's like sticking your fingers in your ears to shut the sound, but the sound is still going on. So Bruce Ames, a marvelous scientist, almost 100 years of age, really smart guy, really impressive guy, he suggested that one cup of coffee has the equivalent in weight of synthetic carcinogens, of the pesticides that a normal person consumes in 1 year. Roasted coffee has 826 volatile chemicals and in numerous of hundreds of non-volatile, 22 were tested chronically in rats and 17 were carcinogenic to the rats. So one cup of coffee contains at least 10 milligrams of carcinogenics and thousands of chemicals not yet tested. Even Bruce Ames, that he's not a raw fooder, says the cooking of food is a great source of potential carcinogenic for rats. The cooking process produces at least 200 milligrams per person. Most of it burned material that is not tested. Much of it are carcinogenic in rats. That's one of the main reasons that I'm against cooked food and I'm against coffee. The roasting process makes it a lot more toxic. But Ellen White, one of the creators of the Adventist Church, almost 200 years ago, and all us natural hygienists were against coffee even 200 years ago. She wrote once, never drink tea, coffee, beer, wine, or any alcoholic beverages. Water should be the best liquid to clean your tissues. Coffee is a harmful satisfaction. Simulate temporarily the brain with an unnecessary action, but the after effect is exhaustion, prostration, paralyzation of your mental faculties, of your moral factors, and of your physical faculties. The mind becomes weakened unless there's effort to drop the coffee habit. The brain activity remains diminished. All these substances are irritants, and in some cases, it's so hard for a coffee drinker to drop its bad habit as it is for an alcoholic to abandon the use of drinking. So do you want my help as a clinical nutritionist to make changes in your lifestyle? Please take a look in Amazon, my Hygienic Fasting Nature Surgery. I have 10 bucks published, but I just translated this one to English so far. But I will be translating other ones. It's available on POD and also available on Kindle. And also we have 6 online courses, the 10 books published, I attend patients online and in person, and also we run retreats here in Brazil, January and July, spending 5 to 10 days learning with me after 17 years of living a natural hygiene lifestyle and teaching this to the public and to health professionals. I believe I can help you out to make good lifestyle changes that will produce health, prevent disease, and raises your lifespan and health span. So, do you want to learn more? Click these videos.